It's been said that the past can linger about a place, that the things that took place there remain somehow. Shadows, perhaps. Echoes.
Can you feel it? The silent spaces are not quite silent. The worn stairways almost seem to ring with the footsteps of 100 years.
It feels lonely now, but there was a time when this was a lively center of life. The walls of red brick, placed one brick at a time by artisans nearly 120 years ago, stand witness to the things that happened here. If you listen, you can almost hear the songs, the laughter, the tears. A legacy still detectable after 115 years. Lives were lived here, workaday lives. Men, women, and even children labored here. Coming from across the county, they built new lives within the layered brick of the mill. Some found love in the midst of the labor. Some died here. Day by day, the universal struggles of life took place, and the mill was at the center of it all.
The Loray Mill bound itself to the people that worked here, intertwining its legacy into the fabric of their lives, so that looking back, the two are remembered as one.
The mill was built by John Love and George Gray with major funding by White & Machine Works out of Massachusetts. It rose from the ground on which it now stands on the backs of brick masons and construction workers, taking shape from piles of brick, timber, stone, and iron. Recruiting Irish bricklayers from the north, it was said a curse word was uttered for every brick laid. It was unique in its size, although similar to other structures in the area that were buzzing with the cotton industry. This structure, dubbed the Loray Mill in honor of its creators, was the largest mill of its kind in the South, and its size and complexity would compete with the best mills in New England, becoming a source of pride and national recognition. Construction began in 1900 and took 2 years to complete and get in operation, at which time it began producing cotton sheeting for export to Shanghai, China. Work in the mill was a hard, hot, and dirty occupation. And with a labor force larger than any other mill in the county, it became a target for what would affect the town for decades. Unionization.
In 1907, a first labor strike was called but died on the vine, and the mill continued until 1919, when it was sold to Jenks Spinning Company of Providence, Rhode Island. In October of that year, a second strike was attempted, which fared no better than the first. Shortly after the second strike, Jenks expanded the mill by adding the Western Addition.
It merged with Manville Mills in 1924 with a continued goal of maintaining profits. In an attempt to cut costs, many workers were fired while those remaining were given larger workloads.
New workers were gathered from among the poor who wanted steady work and would work cheap. The boss men were hard and demanding. Morale was low. And so it was under those conditions that the great Loray Mill continued her career with all hope. But at the confident age of 29, the mill found herself in the middle of a third labor dispute. In an attempt to cut costs even further, headquarters in New England sent in a new superintendent, Gordon Johnstone. His impact was to affect the mill forevermore.
The headquarters in New England sent in Gordon Johnstone to cut cost, to make things more efficient, that people could do more work for in less time. Well, the workers that they had here, of course, did not like that. And it was probably done too severely at the time that you gave them more work and less time, and you wanted them to speed up in doing it, and it just got to a point where they couldn't. They call this the stretch out. That's what the workers called it. And that is what led to the strike in 1929.
In 1929, as the Great Depression loomed, workers rallied. A strike was called, and the divided citizens of Gastonia lived in fear of the monster that had arisen among them.
I remember when the strike was. Oh, yes. I was 6 years old, and my home was over on Spencer Avenue, and we could sit on the front porch and hear guns go off.
The strike was more complicated than just a strike for wage increases and a better time. The Communist Party had taken over the National Textile Workers Union. It was basically a communist union that came in. They were taking their orders directly from Moscow to stir up the capitalistic world. In 1929, April the 1st, in this building, 2,200 people went out on strike.
The eyes of the world were on the mill as the Communist Textile Workers Union led a strike in 1929 that laid siege to the town.
It was a tough time for Gastonia, and I think a lot of people just wanted to forget that it happened, and so they tucked it away, and the ones that were on the side of the strikers knew that they had failed, and the ones that were on the side of the Loray maybe were a little embarrassed about the situation with the workers.
I am 17 years of age. My job in the mill is to fill 34 loom magazines. I earn $3.50 a week trying to support a family of four on this wage.
There was a lot of unhappiness. There was a lot of people who didn't like the Mandible Jeans Company. The supervisors there were difficult to work for. They would stretch the employees out, give them more work. I believe at that time they were working 12-hour shifts, and it was a difficult time.
2 months in, the striking workers began to sense the influence of the Communist Party. Support waned, and the striking force dwindled down from over 2,000 workers to only 200.
The company had ejected them from the village housing. They had a tent colony on the other side of Franklin Boulevard near the Arlington Mill. And that's where they stayed, and they continued to strike and to stir up trouble where they could.
Chief of Police Orville Adderholt, called in one night to regain peace at a rally gone bad, was killed as gunfire erupted. Strike organizer Fred Edwin Beale and 15 others were charged with his murder. Just a few months later, Ella Mae Wiggins, a local balladeer, workers' rights champion, and union organizer, was murdered by a strike opposition mob, further marring what was intended to be the successful unionization of the mill's workforce.
I think it bothered the people in Gastonia a little bit that this had made them look bad. I mean, it was all over the world, actually. It was in Europe. They talked about it over there. So I think they were embarrassed by it. And obviously, history, you need to learn to appreciate both sides of the story, and that people need to be heard, and education and communication is so important.
The conflict was finally over, but with the loss of its best customers and with business failing in an already weakened industry, Manville Jenks fled into bankruptcy, and the Great Loray Mill, largest in the South, was closed, its spindles and batteries silent, but only for a short time. A new industry was on the rise. The mill had changed over to tire cord in 1921, but no one had foreseen the overwhelming success of a new novelty called the automobile. America was in love, and the new beloved was a machine that would change the world forever. The horseless carriage was here to stay, and as America entered the vintage era, new supporting industries were born and would change America yet again. As the mill and a firmly established automobile industry entered the 30s, it was apparent that this new, insatiable beast was more than a novelty. and would require American labor to keep it moving. Men and women were needed to work on the new factories that would produce the parts and pieces that made up the blood and guts of America's new love interest. And the wheels on which this new beast moved were made of rubber. In 1935, Firestone Corporation, a company that had made huge strides in engineering a durable rubber for tires, saw the Loray Mill as a way to maintain its position as the country's leading tire manufacturer. Moving into the mill in the middle of the Great Depression, Firestone Corporation began a half-century occupation weaving the cloth belts that gave the rubber tires stability. Weaving tons of cloth a day, the great looms were fed hundreds of miles of cotton thread as the looms roared over the course of three shifts a day to help quench America's need to rule the roads.
I was born just prior to World War II in this little three-room house on South Van Street, and the backyard was 100 feet from the mill. I could hit the mill with a rock growing up from my backyard. And my earliest memories are of that mill running full blast, three shifts, 7 days a week. It was a symbol of stability at that time because it was such a well-known and prosperous mill. 2,500 people working.
Firestone, as it came to be called, employed several thousand workers and would modify the existing worker management relationship, delivering to the mill worker a new version of prosperity.
It seemed like that the strike dominates everything about the Firestone plant or the old Loray plant. But it shouldn't, because when the Firestone people came, everything changed. The hours were better, the pay was better, the load was completely different, and the strike should not overpower this, because a lot of good came out of Firestone.
Firestone was determined to change the worker experience. No more stretch outs. Workers were treated so well they had no need to go anywhere else. Morale was high and workers were happy. The company village with its stores, homes, pool, and post office became the heart of West Gastonia. And the steady work and the mill village support system allowed workers to weather the balance of the Depression. Then the U.S. entered the Second World War and priorities changed. The war effort required huge amounts of materials to support the troops, an insatiable appetite that required continuous supply. It was then that the mill changed over from cotton to nylon. And while the rest of the country collected tin and planted victory gardens,
the mill was engaged in making war materials. In fact, people involved as employees of the mill were exempt for the most part from military service, or they certainly received exemptions for quite a while, and that was the case with my dad.
World War II was another boom time for textiles, and a very important one for the country. Textiles at that time was one of the major industries of national importance during war years. There were millions of men in service, and they had to be clothed. And so the textile mills were running night and day, producing yarn, which went to weaving companies, which made uniforms. Some companies like Firestone did both the spinning and the weaving, and Cramerton Mills. They are the ones that invented the army, what is called the army khaki. And the spinning mills in Gaston County were sending their yarn to Cramerton and other mills to be made into military clothing. And it wasn't just clothing, there were tents and mosquito netting and all kinds of products.
For their efforts, Firestone received some prestigious awards during wartime. And in spite of the exemptions some of the management got from the draft, there was one problem they had to solve.
The problem was that many of your best spinners and weavers and section men and everything had gone to war. So this was when women were brought in.
Women had worked the mill before, but now they were needed to fill non-traditional roles, and they were good at it.
The women did a lot of the detail work better than men did. You had cost controls, you had priorities, you had tremendous red tape with the government, so it worked out well. And when the men came home, every effort was made to provide those men with jobs as good or better than they had when they left.
Firestone not only changed the way the mill was run, but it changed the attitudes of the workers. Workers felt they had a friend in Firestone and that the company really cared about their welfare. As the war came to a close, things were looking up, and the mill, entering middle age, was just hitting her stride. If the great castle of West Gastonia had a period of Camelot, it would have been during the Firestone era. After the war, the nation prospered like never before. Industry boomed, the future looked bright, and the mill and the surrounding village were not excluded from the optimism.
It was a kind of an idyllic time. And families helped each other, supported each other, grieved with each other. We had a little business area just one block away from the mill. And you had two grocery stores. We had a movie theater. We had a dry goods store or two. You could get everything you wanted within a block or two of the mill.
Also in the neighborhood, we had dry cleaners. We had a drugstore, service stations. I mean, it was just a nice big community. We had carpenters, painters, electricians, plumbers that took care of the houses, that went out, and if you had a commode that was bad, they'd come and fix the commode, or if the water heater was bad, they'd fix this stuff.
The workers prospered, and even the women earned promotions, a thing not often seen at that time.
I went to work in 1946 as a payroll clerk, and then I moved over into the department where my supervisor is, and I worked up to be supervisor. I worked there 36 years, and I loved every minute of it.
May Jones, a former mill worker and resident of Gastonia, got a promotion her last 5 years employed at the mill.
I worked in a machine shop, which was a good job for me. I made more money and did less work, got to quit, like the men, we quit at 3. So I got to do like that. To me, it was a good life. And I have friends. I know one in particular, Alma Westbrooks. She said, "May, the happiest days of my life was when I lived right there on Firestone."
There was a great deal of pride amongst the employees about having a job at Firestone.
There was a very real sense of community and pride at Firestone that was reflected in the monthly company publication, the Firestone News. It recognized service milestones by workers and featured stories about the other perks and programs. There was a Firestone softball team, a scout troop, Easter egg hunts, Camp Firestone, a summer camp for kids, open houses for the community, and no one was forgotten at Christmas.
They gave the children a Christmas gift, and they'd have a party for them, and it'd be a nice little gift they bought for the children.
And their support didn't stop there. In the post-war era, education became very important to Americans.
There were very few high school graduates working in the mill during those years. But they wanted their children to have that opportunity. In 1953, the Firestone Tire and Rubber Company announced that it would begin to give scholarships to sons and daughters of Firestone employees. And Firestone had plants all over the world at that time. And they initiated a program whereby they gave 20 scholarships each year on a competitive basis. And during my senior year in high school, the second year of the program, I won one of those scholarships. And that scholarship was a full four-year scholarship to any college or university in the United States. Firestone made it possible for me to go to college. And all of that happened within the context of that mill village environment.
I can't think of anything any better. I think that I grew up in the best of times.
It was a time in Gastonia that mirrored 100 small towns all over America and would be remembered in Gastonia as the glory days of the Loray Mill. The mill, well into her 80s, continued to serve as Firestone continued to innovate within their industry. The company stayed with the mill as long as it could, but ultimately her age began to show, and she was just unable to support their progress into the next century. Sadly, after 93 years of faithful service, the Loray Mill was abandoned to time. It had been quite a life. The Loray Mill lifespan had so far survived three strikes in the Great Depression, two world wars, a space race, a Cold War, and the commencement of the computer age. Before she reached old age, she was no longer able to care for herself. It was in 1993 that the mill was abandoned by Firestone for newer and more modern facilities in Kings Mountain, just a few miles away. They are there to this day. But as Firestone moved on, it meant the end of an era, and things at the old mill were never to be the same again.
Since the mill has been left standing all these years, the current generation of Gastonians has no real recollection of that mill and what it meant, and what it meant to the economy. It's almost as if this new generation asks of us, what did that mill used to do?
It's a symbol of who we are. It's kind of like our soul. Gastonia was built on the textile business. And so to lose that symbol of our soul, it would have been horrible to have lost it.
The Great Loray Mill, its spindles and looms removed, the doors locked, was sentenced to what would become 20 years of solitary confinement.
There was a lot of heartbreak involved. The fact that the major part of the mill was closed. And there was frankly some sense that the mill would eventually come down.
We started finding these things that we thought just couldn't be thrown away. So we started looking at all this stuff and saying, wow, we've got to put this somewhere because it's going to disappear.
Signs. Bits of paper. Tools. Tools. All bits and pieces of mill life left behind.
I just know there's going to be somebody that walks in that mill and says, My dad sat on that stool right there. That was his. I just feel like that all of those are very personal pieces.
Nearly 100 years had passed. History was made. Lives were lived. And now the great castle of West Gastonia would languish. It would have to wait for what would become the next chapter in the narrative that tells the tale of many lives. But would there be another chapter? By 2001, the great Loray Mill, now on life support, was about to have the plug pulled. But as she celebrated her 101st birthday, there were champions that would come to her aid.
I first became involved with the Loray Mill not long after I returned to the city in 1992, when it was known that Firestone was building a new plant at the western edge of the city. I called up the economic development director of Gaston County and said, well, what's going to happen to that old building, you know, the Firestone Mill, Loray Mill? And he said, well, they're probably going to implode it.
There were no ready prospects, and it wasn't looking good. One fact that actually saved the mill from early demolition was its size.
It would have cost an incredible amount of money to bring the mill down, or I think we would have lost the mill. So I think the fact that it was so large was probably what saved it in the long run.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Shannon Vickery. Thanks for joining us. It was called the Million Dollar Mill when it was built in Gastonia in 1902, and for good reason. The Loray Mill was the largest textile mill under one roof in the South and one of the largest in the world. It closed in 1993, and not long after, Preservation North Carolina took over the property and has tried to find a developer. The group has also paid for a night watchman and a sprinkler system to help preserve the huge complex. Tonight, there's news that a complex mix of federal and state housing and historic preservation credits have been approved, and work to redevelop the massive mill into a mix of residential and commercial use will begin next month.
There is only rust and silence around the gate buzzer now. Debris covers the cracked and broken sidewalk. The vines climbing the walls keep watch over the yard outside. You will not find much hope in the vastness of Loray Mill towering over Gastonia. But then, amidst the decay, you notice the star.
I don't recall exactly when Firestone first put the stars up, but I know they were up every year for a long, long time before 1993, when Firestone vacated this building. In 2006, my son kept saying that he'd like to see those stars go back up. And I knew nothing about how it could be done, but out of pure luck, I found Mr. Richard Pettiger. And he told me that the stars were in existence somewhere, but he didn't know where, but he thought he'd find out.
With no one in the city to support the effort, Cliff did what Gastonians have always done.
I said, well, if it's going to happen, we're going to have to do it ourselves. So that's when I started looking around for some people to help me, and thankfully I did. And that was the nucleus of the group that's still in there doing it all the time.
And after a lot of work and determination, the stars were once again seen over Gastonia. But it was going to take more than that to keep the Loray Mill alive.
I remember Lucy and I talking about, she said, well, maybe we can at least save the tower to the building. And I said, we need to save the whole thing. And we both agreed to that. And then I think with a lot of persuasion from her and interest by Preservation North Carolina, that organization stepped forward on a leap of faith and was able to convince Firestone to donate the building to Preservation North Carolina.
About the time we began to think about Loray as a viable project, I became chairman of the board of Preservation North Carolina. So it was during that time that we really picked up the interest in the project, and it was also during that time when the title passed to Preservation North Carolina.
And so without a developer, they moved forward on that leap of faith to the building, were able to recruit a developer not long after that.
It was going to be a tough go for any developer, no matter how qualified.
Well, we had a couple of false starts. You know, we had, after Firestone moved out, there was a group that came in and tried to figure out how to do it. They couldn't quite get it done. And then a second group the same way.
So Preservation North Carolina went seeking for another developer. And they were able to bring in John Gumpert with Camden and other interested investors, and that began the journey of to where we are today. And in fact, they had financing and equity arranged by early 2008, but unfortunately we all know what happened in 2008 in terms of the economy.
With the economic downturn of 2008 arresting further progress, the fate of the mill was as yet unclear. Would the new developer be able to weather this new economic storm and keep the dream alive? Great intent and the importance of historic preservation notwithstanding, for a project of this magnitude to succeed, it had to be profitable.
First off, you know, you have to realize that it's an iconic building. It is so important to Gastonia and so important to our heritage, but simply the intrinsic value of historic preservation is not enough, certainly not enough to save a building of that magnitude. You have to find another use.
What it needed was someone with the commercial vision and practical experience to see it through.
Back in 2005, I was living in Atlanta, and John Gumpert called me and said, "I've got our next project for us." I said, "Great, John, where's our next project?" And he says, "It's in Gastonia, North Carolina." And my first question to him was, "Where's Gastonia, North Carolina?"
So we met the owner of the mill here, took a 20-minute tour through the building, and I told the owner, "We'll do it." And he looked at me like, "You gotta be kidding me." I said, "No, we'll get it done." Didn't know how, but knew there was an opportunity. And from that point on, we've been working on the mill. That was probably 9 years ago.
Welcome to a wonderful, wonderful occasion. I'm John Bridgman, I'm your mayor. I would at this time like to call on John Gumpert from Atlanta, who's been very, very instrumental to Camden Partners. Come on up and speak to us. John.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm John Gumpert. I'm proud to be a partner of the Loray Mill redevelopment. Having closed the long-awaited financing, we're excited to immediately commence construction on this $40 million redevelopment of this magnificent project.
Is this a great day or what? Oh. Yes! Yeah.
The mill has been, up to now, to this point in time, an opportunity for Gastonia, an opportunity to save, without doubt, its most prominent historical building in Gastonia, Gaston County, and to create, with that saving of that building, a catalyst for new development in the western part of Gastonia. It will have a very healthy effect on the city as a whole.
With funding finally secured, and all the key players in place, it was time to begin. The mill, sitting idle for 20 years, was saggy and battered, but it would take more than 20 years of neglect to keep her down. Activity began to swarm around the mill, a new resurgence of life in the form of architects, electricians, plumbers, structural engineers, welders, carpenters, experts in all fields of construction. The great mill, bricks intact, needed a lot of work done. As the workers rallied, key changes were made in the infrastructure. New plumbing, new power, and updates all around to bring the tired lady up to code. Some parts were removed and other parts added. Discoveries were made, new uses determined, and then about 2 years, 20 years of neglect were shaken off as the 115-year-old Loray Mill made ready her debut to the community.
The funny thing is about this project, it's enormous. Just the mass of the building itself, it's 600,000 square feet. Every day you're gonna have issues. Every day you're gonna have problems that you need to solve. And that's what makes it fun. You see, back in 2005, when we pieced this together, we just put together a set of plans that we knew would work, but didn't put a whole lot of thought to it. As we got closer to the city of Gastonia, as we got closer to the people and the citizens around here in the county of Gaston, we understood that there was a passion behind this building. We understood better the historical significance of the building. And we understood economically what a building and a project like this could potentially do for the west side of Gastonia. So after we closed last year, we revisited the plans and ended up redesigning the entire building. You drive up and you look at the six stories of brick that they just don't build anymore. You look at these historic windows that you just don't see anymore. You just can't replicate this building again. And you have the wow factor. And it is inspiring. At the end of the day, it's all rewarding. And we have a sense of what a building can do economically to a city or to an area. And we hope that happens here.
The old is still recognizable in the new. Floors walked by thousands for over 100 years are now walked again. New windows shed new light, as what was nearly lost is found once more. On March 30th, 2015, the first open house in 25 years was held at the mill. People came from all over the state to witness the results of over 10 years of trial and error. It was another milestone in the journey of the great castle of West Gastonia from birth to rebirth, and a testament of what can be done when people with vision work together.
Today, Gastonia is the best of North Carolina. I'm just thinking about the 3,000 and more people who used to work in this building. I'm thinking about all the people in this room and many people before you who had a dream of never tearing this place down and making it come to life again. When Ronald Reagan started the historical tax credit program, he wanted to encourage private sector investments and entrepreneurship in revitalizing these types of buildings. And now we need to do it for the rest of the state. Now is no time to cut off the historical tax credits. So I want all of us, I'm going to try to invite every senator from the whole state of North Carolina to come to this mill right here. Come to Loray Mill.
This is not a one-man show. This truly took a community. There was never one person. Lucy has been doing this for 20 plus years. Jack Kaiser was just pushing this through the city. Without Jack, it doesn't happen. Without Lucy, it doesn't happen. Without Carl, Carl went back when he was the House Speaker, and he got another 20% mill credit developed just simply for Loray Mill. Without that, this deal doesn't happen. Without the local preachers, there was a time in about 2010 when the county supervisors had said, we're done. You people have no money. You're never going to get this done. And they were going to put a vote on it. And the local preachers heard about that, most of the Baptist ministers. They showed up at the county supervisors meeting and said, you do not shut this down. This is good for our community. This is good for our people. And you do not stop this. Without them, that deal would have closed in 2010. Without HUD stepping in and supporting us, it never would have gotten done. Without Myrick Howard at Preservation North Carolina not getting his checks, there were months when we couldn't pay him, and he said, just pay me when you can. It never would have gotten done. If we had a hardline lender, would have been gone. I mean, there's nobody you can point to that said, including us, those guys made it happen. Yes, we're the developer. Yeah, we pushed it over the goal line. but the first 90 yards were done by everybody else.
This new Loray Mill will bind itself to the lives of the people that will live and work here, intertwining its legacy into the fabric of their lives, so that looking back, the two will become inseparable.
This building was built 112 years ago, and when it was built, it created a city. And the surrounding mill village, with all its homes, was the community that you lived in. When the factory shuts down, it deflates the entire community. What we hope happens, and we've seen this in the past, is that this rejuvenates, re-energizes this side of town.
I love old buildings like this. I love taking buildings that are dormant, ready to be torn down, and turn them into something that's productive. I love seeing the neighborhoods revitalize. I love being able to say, hey, I played a role in that.
We want this to become a city center. We want this to be a destination location. This is why we've designed it in such a way where we're not cutting it off from the community, but inviting the community to be part of it. We've got a lot of common area space, we've got a lot of commercial space, and we're marketing this to the commercial tenants that will attract outside vendors.
Most people think of this new development as a project that will change West Gastonia. That is absolutely true. But this project is larger than anything we have ever seen in Gaston County. It's going to transform Gastonia as a city, and it's going to transform this county. We're going to have people coming from all over the country and all over the world to see this project. It's going to do more for Gastonia than any project ever has in its history. It's the realization of a great dream that many of us have had for many years. And it's a symbol of hope, a symbol of aspiration, something we believed would draw people in and would make our city and community more vibrant, and now we see that it has indeed done just that. This is what we always intended, and this is what we are so thankful for.
So now, against the odds, the Loray Mill, once the largest cotton mill in the South, is reborn. The walls of red brick, placed by artisans long gone, will ring with laughter once more. Lives will be lived here. It will become again a lively center of life and commerce. And the walls, standing witness to the legacy of nearly 120 years, will add new chapters to a story whose end is not yet written.
And I think the impact it's going to make will be so significant to that side of town that we'll look back on this time and we'll say, how could we not have done this? This would have been a travesty to have lost this mill.
The great Loray Mill, now restored to glory, stands as a symbol of what can be accomplished by people with vision. And that is the legacy of the Castle of West Gastonia.